Welcome, everyone. Today we are going to talk about how to load our websites or progressive web apps faster than the normal. And the main direction, the topic is about the size. The smaller the size, we have the faster loading times. So we are going to dig about how we can have the smaller size, smaller files, and faster loading times. My name is Bilal. I'm working as a software engineer at Adidas. And mainly in the projects, I'm working as a front-end architect, usually creating the libraries, frameworks, and defining our structures, how we can use our JavaScript frameworks. And before moving on, I really like to share this slide almost every presentation I had, because it is basically summarize our pain or maybe our desire for the web as a front-end developer. As you can see, in the wild, there are vast amount of different sizes, computers, technologies, phones, networks. And as a front-end developer and as a web developer, we don't even know how our clients are going to use our websites. Are they going to use Safari, Chrome? Are they using 3G, Wi-Fi, white screen, small screen, from mobile, from an old computer, everything? And our biggest desire to have is user happiness. So when we talk about user happiness, actually it is basically, it is the time we are going to show something to our clients when they are surfing our websites. And as you can see in the picture, and from first pain time to first meaningful screen, we are going to show the clients, and first time to interactive. So at that time, users can start to click the links or navigate inside the pages. This is our user happy path, and we are going to achieve this part, this time to interaction part, as fast possible. So how fast can we be? And how can we achieve this fastness? First, we need to apply some best practices, and we also dedicatedly invest something in our codes. So we need to analyze, we need to optimize, and repeat this journey as the technology changes, as the new frameworks or libraries are going to wild, or new versions of browsers are shipped. So, by the means, best practices, in terms of mobile web delivery, we can split best practices in two parts. For every type of files, we can apply, and for JavaScript files, we can apply. And in the left part, as you can see, we can apply these best practices for every part of file, like CSS files, HTML files, JavaScript files, even sometimes images. So we can compress, pre-solve their DNS, and preload their critical resources according to our needs, or we can minify, optimize everything inside. And in terms of JavaScript, we have a little more flexibility. We can split the code according to our routes, according to our page, so we can serve as small as possible file size and code size according to the page we are viewing. And we can think about as a journey. It's basically, nowadays is really a hype term, journey. You can hear it in every part of our digital technology and transformation. And sometimes we can gain these performance achievements and the best practices achievements with small changes in our codes. So with having a small change, we can have a big performance gain. So, how our journey is starting? First thing is first, being progressive. Have you ever heard of the term progressive web apps? Nowadays, for the last two years, I think since 2016, Google has shipped this term extensively in every side of our internet applications. And nowadays, most of the frameworks like Angular, Vue, React are adapting this progressive web apps terminology and working style in their own coding style. So, what is progressive web apps? Actually, progressive web apps is meaning you can think about three things. It should be fast, it can work offline, and it will be stable. So, by means offline and stable, you can have progressive web apps load instantly and immediately start showing something when you are trying to view the web app. And with their offline networking and offline caching capabilities, in some cases, you don't even need network connection. So maybe you are in a remote part of the world, or sometimes in a subway, in a metro, or we are in Germany, in U-Bahn. Think about you don't have an internet connection at that time, but and you want to come to this conference hall, so you can open your conference web page, load it as a progressive web apps, and you can see the address, even Google Maps, working perfectly during at that time. And this without network connection capabilities and loading and pre-caching things are actually supply us amazingly fast loading times and amazingly fast interaction times. Usually, clients, when they are viewing a website, they are expecting to see something in the first 5 seconds. So if you cannot show something meaningful or something interactive to your clients, to your visitors, usually they leave your website. For example, if you think about Forbes website, when they adapt their website to progressive web apps, the loading time is reduced as low as 2.5 seconds. So in 2.5 seconds, you can have a meaningful paint and time to interactive action. So you can start to view the website and navigate through the pages. And with this progressive web app approach, they increase their impressions up to 10%. When we think about Twitter Lite, Twitter Lite is loading around 3 seconds. And with these progressive web app capabilities, they're commenting and their tweeting increases almost 70% in their Twitter Lite version. But loading is time-consuming and resource-consuming thing, especially in terms of JavaScript, because JavaScript needs parsing. As you can see in the graph, and most of the websites actually spend their most of the time in terms of client interaction, like browser compiling time and the parsing time, they spend most of the times in their parse stage. For example, if you think about mobile phones, and in average phone, in the case we can think about Moto 4G, 1 megabyte of JavaScript uncompressed file parsing time is almost 2 seconds. And as your phone's CPUs, memory, become better and better, it is closer to the desktops. For example, at the top you can see iPhone 8 and the MacBook Pro is almost have the same similar performance in terms of parsing JavaScript. But usually we need to think about average phone because not everyone can have iPhone 8 or latest technologies or edge technologies in their hand. So we need to consider average phone. And in terms of average phone, you can see, for example, JavaScript loading and parsing in total in iPhone 8, it's almost 4 seconds. And for the average phone, you need additional 9 seconds to parsing your JavaScript. So you almost triple your needs according to your device capabilities. So in terms of shipping parsable, easy parsable code, we can follow some patterns. The most popular pattern is called purple pattern. Purple pattern means push, render, preload, and precache and lazy load. This means in the very first time to your visible content, push the minimal code to the website. Like according to your design, maybe you have at the top of your website, you have a hero banner and a menu, maybe and the login screen. So during that time, only push or serve this type of codes to show your hero banner menu working properly. Then wait for user spend some time in your page, and then try to render other needs like second pages or footer menu, other navigations, other contents. Then start to cache them in your browser's cache. So by this pattern, you can easily have shipped small amount of code every time to user needs. So if they don't ask anything, you don't ship anything. And think about you have a budget. Remember, I said clients or your visitors expect at least seeing something in your first 5 seconds. When we drill down this first 5 seconds, actually, at first 1.6 seconds is consuming for DNS lookup, TCP handshake, or HTTP handshake. So after for these 5 seconds, you only have actually 3.4 seconds to show or ship something. So in average or slow 3G network, in 3.4 seconds, you can ship around 170 kilobytes file size. What does this mean? Think about your application. So your application core itself, your framework you are using, the routers, other utilities, and your critical path HTML and CSS files, in total should have 170 kilobytes. So you have this type of budget. And you need to evaluate this budget for your network transfer, parse and compile time, and runtime costs. So in 5 seconds, you are expecting to have a network transfer, parsing your code, compiling your code, and having time to interaction. So as a result, the recipe is going to start with JavaScript. So your JavaScript execution time is most time-consuming part. So what we need for building a good web app. First, we need to think about average font size and average font technologies like Moto 4G. Then we need to ship minimal amount of code for the first interaction. And we need to try to interact less than 5 seconds with the keeping our mind having a maximum file size of 170 kilobytes. Additionally, according to our new technologies and new capabilities, we need to change our coding styles. Has anyone building website, web application in their companies, in their daily work? Are you bundling all your resources in single files, like big JavaScript file, big CSS file, like that? You need to change your coding style. You need to split your codes in smaller chunk, consumable. Maybe you can think about eatable chunks. For changing our coding style, we can use a good tool called Webpack. Webpack is a module bundler, and it has lots of perks. It has ability to code splitting, chunking, tree shaking, like removing unneeded code or unused code from our code base, or also even separate our vendor bundles and our application bundles differently and increase our catchability. And more on coding style changes. For example, we can adapt modern JavaScript usage with the help of Babel library. So we can start to use ES6, modern JavaScript, and modern core JavaScript improvements in our coding. And with the help of Babel, we can transpile less codes and only needed code, like according to our target browsers, according to our target mediums. For example, if we are shipping a code only for Node.js and server environment, we can eliminate browser-specific codes from our libraries and application with the help of Babel preset environment and module configuration, for example. We can split codes according to our needs, so we can have small consumable chunks, like only a small bunch of code, CSS, HTML, and JavaScript codes, only for login page, only for products page, only for accounts page. And we can load blazingly fast these files, since they are going to a smaller size, when users ask to load them. Tree shaking is another approach that, according to our application, the Webpack rollup or closure compiler tools are analyzing our codes and removing unneeded code or methods from our application source code. And we can use wisely our utility methods or utility libraries like Lodash or Moment.js, so we can only include their only needed parts in our codes. For example, normally Moment.js is the most popular time-related, date-related JavaScript library, and its core size is around 1 megabyte. So it's only you are adding time-related or calendar-related methods for your needs, and it's 1 megabyte. And most of these size coming from their actually localization from translation. So if you don't support any language other than German or English, don't add these locals to your source code. And think about you are working in a laboratory. So prepare a dedicated environment to your code, to your application, and test them wisely. These tools actually can help your this lab environment. Chrome DevTools, as most of you know from Google Chrome, so when you hit F12, so you are going to see the DevTools, and you can find lots of things and lots of suggestions according to your coding style. Lighthouse is another tool coming from Google. It's also embedded in Chrome DevTools, and Lighthouse, like the web page test, analyzes your web application and gives you suggestions, like analyzes your time to interactive, analyzes your bundle size, or ability to compressing your files or other needs. So according to its suggestion, you can improve your or optimize your own codes. And in terms of your journey, finally, you can use new techniques to improve your loading times. For example, if your fonts don't load immediately, for example, if you are using 10-12 font sites, different font files in your design, and sometimes they can have a file size up to 1 megabyte. So you need some time to download these fonts and apply to your design. By the help of new font display property, as you can see in the image, actually you can optionate your font size behavior, so how your font display. For example, let me replay. You see first this and this part, and first and fourth one is actually waiting for loading and downloading the font size font file actually. So at that time you will see a blank screen for the font replacement. But for the other font display swap optional or fallback version, you see a standard defined font face, and it will replace eventually when your font downloads. And at that time, your user actually see something readable on their screen, not any blank areas. For example, you cannot know where your clients or your visitors are viewing your website. Like if they're in their home using Wi-Fi, if they're in using 3G, 2G, even Edge. So you can serve adaptive serving according to your network connection speed. In JavaScript, you can use navigator connection type or effective type variables to differ your loading times or serving file sizes. Anyone using Netflix? According to your screen size or according to your network size, you will see sometimes Netflix videos are starting with really blurry images, then by the time it starts really sharp, and sometimes for ultra HD sizes. So actually they are testing your connection speed according to their serving files, then they immediately switch their files according to your network. So immediately, if your network goes slows down, your images and your videos become a little blurry or pixelate. Then when it improves your connection, it immediately switch back to the HD versions. They are using these checks according to serving your files. And with the preloading and async cache, actually you can start to load your critical source immediately. For example, you are going to have a web page showing a movie list, and you want to show these movies as fast as possible. You can preload your data, then immediately and asynchronously, you can start to fetch the data and start to show something for your clients according to your coded data. And with the navigation preload thing, you can bypass the service workers startup or booting sequence, which means that you can parallelly start to load your own root-based code and service worker altogether. Now, let's see some real-world applications and real-world gains, how we can load the web page fast. We have two case studies. One is from Pinterest website, and one is Tinder. I think both of these websites are known to you. Think about Pinterest. It's almost sharing about images or sharing, pinning your likes and storing to your account. To begin with, Pinterest moved to progressive web apps last year, and before moving it, they have Android version application. It's around 10 megabytes, and the iOS version was almost 60 megabytes. And with the progressive web apps, actually for the they reduced the file size almost under than 200 kilobytes. And note that the progressive web app and the native apps, it's not comparing the apple to apples, it's a little apple to bananas. But in terms of visualization, we can think about with the progressive web apps, we are going to have less file size in the mobile devices. And what are their gains? According to old mobile version to the new mobile web app, progressive web app, they almost doubled everything. So the core engagement is increased 60%. Spending time more than 5 minutes almost increased 50%. And as you can see, user-generated ads and ad click-throughs is almost increased, doubled according to old version. And when they compare the native version of their application and the progressive web app version, even they have slight gains in progressive web app version. In their old mobile site, in the drill down of first meaningful paint, time to interactive, you'll see it's almost 23 seconds that users can start to interact with the website. And progressive web app actually has 5.6 seconds. time to interactive. And the good thing is about the progressive web apps is actually in your repeat loads, your speeds increase enormously. For the second time of visit, or third time, or maybe fifth time, you'll see it's the first paint reduced less than 1 second, and the time to interactive become less than 4 seconds. So it is really a big achievement from 23 seconds to the 4 seconds. And according to the file sizes and the page load sizes, almost everything is become more than 50% reduced. So, how they achieve this? First, they started with a splitting strategy. So, they split their code, JavaScript code, according to their needs. First, they separate the vendor code from their original application JavaScript code. Then, they create an entry JavaScript file which loads essential JavaScript code in order to work perfectly or almost inevitably while you are viewing the website. And they separate other root chunks according to user navigates from one page to other page. So, as you can see, the file sizes, it's all sizes are less than 100 kilobyte, and in total, we can think about it is our budget, in our budget. So our budget was, estimated budget was 170 kilobytes, and this is around 150. These are some code samples, how they configured their webpack. As you can see, they have vendor entry chunk for web and entry chunk for mobile. And as you see here, they separate also internalization, polyfills, or other frameworks from their original application code. And they applied dynamic routing with the React router. So you can see the routing, the routing root bundles are loading as they need it. This is also the samples, very, very basic samples, how they achieve this dynamic loading. And they use webpack's bundle analysis. This is a webpack module. It's called webpack bundle analyzer. And it checks your old chunks and code and shows you a beautiful graph that how your application and how your components in your application is sharing the similar codes or dependencies. In their application, they figure out they have lots of duplicate codes in the root chunks. So page dedicated chunk files actually shared some codes with other pages. Then they moved this common code to their entry chunk. The entry size increased 20%, but as a gain, the root chunks actually decrease about 60% to 90%. So for example, for the home feed, it become from 14 kilobytes to 1 kilobyte, or close-up page, it's become 18 kilobytes to 7 kilobytes. So drastically reduced the chunk sizes. And this image is generated from Webpack model bundle analyzer, and as you can see, this is before splitting the common code, and the similar shape actually means that these parts are having the duplicate code. They have the similar codes. So you can check graphically that which chunk or which part of application actually has duplicate code or shared code. Then you can organize your code more wisely. And after moving common code to the entry chunk size file, you can see that there are more individual shapes and more bigger entry modules, but as you can, as a result, they reduced almost 90% of their code. They also adapt service worker caching. With the service worker caching, actually, service workers are a JavaScript technology that they can run in the background of your browser. So in some cases, even your website is not open, your registered service worker code can run in the background. This is, for example, how web push notifications are working now. Even your website, maybe browser, is closed, but you can still get web push from Facebook, Twitter, or anywhere you have subscribed. They are using a toolbox called Workbox, and this is backed by Google. And with the help of Workbox, actually, you can pre-cache images, styles, JavaScript files, and easily define a cache list, which is going to be stored in browser cache and which is going to be run when as they need it. And finally, they create an application shell pattern. And in this application shell pattern, actually, progressive web apps has an ability to save in your iPhones or in your Android phone's home screen. So when you save a progressive web app as an icon in your phone, actually it also saves some part of codes inside your phone. So which means actually it's a storage, a caching mechanism that you can easily speed up your opening up or boot up time. So very needed part, they store the common styles and the base styles for showing up the application in their application shell, so it's even speed up their booting time. And they can also have more optimized thing in the future according to the APIs and other technology achievements. For example, preloading as scripts, it helps to preload your bundles and other things. In the Tinder case, this is a screenshot from Google Lighthouse tool. So in the Lighthouse, you can it checks your website and it gives you a meaningful output about your paint times, interactive times, and other page speeds, and even more things. So for the Tinder case, their speed gains is a little smaller than the Pinterest, but still meaningful. And they keep in their mind our performance budgets and our file size budgets. So in terms of vendor chunk, main chunk, and the common chunks, it's still in a considerable small amount size. They are using root-based code splitting. This is basic import script from ES6 and Node.js. And you can import codes from different files and use them according to your needed parts of application. And from this static root-based code splitting, they moved to dynamic loading with the React loadable component. So instead of loading the files, root files statically, they start load as they need it. And they call when they need it. So before having this dynamic root-based code splitting, their main bundle size is almost 170 kilobytes. Their load time is 12 seconds, and DOM content load is 5.5 seconds. And after dynamic splitting, their load size reduced from 12 to 5 seconds, and main bundle size reduced from 170 to 109 kilobytes. As you can see, this gradually decrease in their average load time. And they also improve the JavaScript caching. It's as same as in the Pinterest case. So they separate their vendors from their own application code, and it's improve caching and reusability across the platform. And they applied the preloading as script methodology, which means that instead of blocking something according to load and other resources, you can actually start to load them synchronously. This is the help of link preload as script definition. They're also using bundle analyzer plugin. And they check needed and unneeded files according to their code. For example, in the login page, they decide is this Google Map is needed or these other files are needed. And they selectively removed unneeded files according to their chunks. And they adapt atomic CSS methodology. So they convert all their design to atomic CSS. So in atomic CSS, actually, you define single responsibility classes according to your design. Like one is only for margins, one is only for paddings, or color, or buttons. And you combine all these class names in your component to get an overall view. So with this atomic CSS, they increase reusability, which means decreasing in file size. And also during the runtime performance, they defer some of the non-critical page actions or file loadings to request idle callback part. For example, you start to read something in your page, and at that time you are reading a certain part, which means you are not actually moving your page or scrolling down. You become an idle, and it starts to load additional non-critical actions or files and pre-cache in your application cache, which means in further calls, these files is going to be available already, which means it loads immediately. Even they update their tooling from Webpack 2 to Webpack 3. It's also decrease the parsing time, and with the upgrading their framework versions. It's also decreased the chunk sizes and also decreased the loading time. Again, they're also using workbooks for defining their cacheable things to achieve their fast loading pages. You can find more on these topics by internet. It's mostly available in Google's developer pages and as a big blog post. You can have the detailed analysis of all things we covered here. Any questions? Dan, thank you.